How to develop a relapse prevention plan. This is important to sit down, preferably with someone who's gone through this before, your sponsor, if you will, or somebody else you know who's gone through and has some sobriety under their belt. And so the idea is to list out, break things down, like what are the triggers that lead to my drug use? Usually it's a relapse can be dissected and broken down into what happened prior. And one of the most common things I hear is people stop going to meetings. They stop being connected to other people. That isolation is super dangerous. So that's just one example there, is to identify times when I'm vulnerable. And I'm vulnerable when I'm not connected with others. Identifying certain emotions that trigger me, whether it's happiness and joy, or if it's sadness and depression. Both of them can be equally strong triggers. So identifying emotions, recognizing when things are building up, and that when I'm and one of the most important things is to identify when it is that I'm catering to this notion of using again. That is super dangerous, but it's part of recovery, is that a person will constantly have episodes where they do think back to the good times and when they want to use again. But it's important to recognize this is a super dangerous time and to be able to voice their concerns. So another aspect of relapse prevention is to speak up and speak to your sponsor or to a loved one to let them know that you're having a hard time. So connection with others also can be within a self-help group. So starting a relapse prevention group, being connected with others is super important as opposed to the isolation of addiction. Learning how to not let a slip grow into anything more serious. So there's a lapse and then there's a relapse. There's lots of different terminology here, but a slip or a lapse is when somebody uses again, but that doesn't necessarily imply that they're back to their old ways of lying and deceiving, and that's a full relapse in that situation. There is a difference, and there is a stepwise approach from the lapse or slip to a full relapse, and the key is to not allow this to progression to happen. That is a super important part of relapse prevention, is to take ownership, to speak up if I've used again, to not hide it, because that's part of the behavior that's associated with a severe relapse, and to be able to take ownership and speak about it with others, and for others to accept that this is a part of the illness. It's not easy for people. They've developed ways of coping maladaptively by using their drug of choice, and it takes time to undo that behavior and to learn new ways. Finally, other ways to develop a plan is to think about things like recreation, activities that you can do that are fun and enjoyable, and to make sure it's balanced with work, that there's not too much of one or the other. And finally, to plan ahead for high risk situations, like when you it's unavoidable when you need to be with people who you know are using, or going to a wedding, for example, when it's socially acceptable. To plan ahead as to what you might want to do should you experience an uncomfortable situation. So to summarize again, to develop a relapse prevention plan, it's best to do this with another person. This could be your sponsor, it could be a drug treatment counselor, and to list out the things that are triggers, things that cause cravings, how to cope with the craving, how to cope with stresses in life, how to cope with uncomfortable situations, to plan ahead for stressful times, like when it's unavoidable, when you need to be with other people who you know are using or drinking, and to be able to develop a lifestyle where there's complete honesty and candidness. That's a very important part of ongoing recovery. So thanks for listening, and if you have any questions, then leave it in the comment box below.